We are a nation of pioneers. Brave men and women who dream remarkable dreams and overcome incredible odds. We are heirs to a legacy of discovery, from the outermost stretches of reality to the innermost sanctity of humanity. Our melodies resonate with innovation, and the sacrifice of our brothers and sisters reminds us that this freedom came at a cost we were willing to pay. Some have reveled in their greatness, while others quietly changed the future. And yet history reminds us over and over again that there is only one who is truly great, one truly innovative, the only one who went before us. He is our founding father. The history of his church in America is one of revelation and inspiration, a history of passion and of brokenness. It is a history of revival, of division, of growth. And in this rich and diverse history exists a common thread, a lifeblood, our native tongue. Prayer is the language of the people of God. We are a people of many ideas, doctrines, positions, and perspectives, but we all speak the common language of prayer. It is time now for the church to remember her native tongue and to retrieve it from the ground where it has been trampled, from the dark cupboards where it has been neglected, because the humble language of the church, united, has the power to change a nation. This language reminds us that if our God is for us, who can be against us? It reminds us that this land is His land, and we, the people, are citizens of an everlasting kingdom. The purple mountains are a mark of His majesty. The amber waves move at His command. His word is the constitution by which the whole universe breathes and abides. All things have been created through Him and for Him. He is the inventor of the inventor. He is the author of every author. He is more than a picture of love. He is the painter of it. He is love. His children know His voice. He calls every one of them by name. His story is the true tale of how love conquered all. We the people are His people. We declare dependence on Him. We are proud of this earthly home, but we remember He is the bright morning star. His stripes are the stripes that saved humanity. Jesus is the hope of America. Jesus is the hope of the world.
The power. Power, I got splendor of a king, clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. We sing, how great. And oh, we'll see how great. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end. Beginning and the end, the Godhead three in one. You are Father, Spirit, and Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great. Declare that tonight. How great. Come on, church, we sing. How great. God some praise. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Worship Night in America. I pray that this is the most significant night that has ever come from Madison Square Garden. The church gathered to pray. You know, tonight we are gathered. We're in many streams of the church. There are many of us in this place. There's all kinds of different backgrounds, all kinds of different, you know, denominations and flavors and streams, and we come from all different places. But I love that we are united tonight under one flag, under one banner, and that is the name of Jesus, the church of Jesus, his name, one song tonight. Every heart on this stage is about the same thing. And there's power when the brothers and sisters come in harmony. There's power when the church comes together in unity. There's power when we're one people. And so, could we just welcome the King of all kings, the Lord Jesus, in this place? Can we give a... Come on, church. We give a welcome to God. We give a welcome to the Most High God, Almighty God. Yes. An ovation of ovations, a standing ovation to the King of every king, the Lord of every Lord, the healer of nations.
Well, unity is a value I think all humanity is striving for. I mean, we could have unity in cause or vision or love or generosity, but there's something much deeper that the church can achieve in this idea of unity, because it's not just emotional, it's not just a mindset, it's not just a country or a sports team, it's this spiritual unity that we can only achieve through the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And that unity is a powerful thing. Actually, in John 17, Jesus is praying for us, all believers that are to come in future generations. He's praying for us to be one in the Father, just as he and the Father are one. Jesus is praying for the unity of all believers to come, because there's going to be so much power in that. It says so that the world may see and believe in the Father.
When I think of unity in the context of the church, I always have to think back to my father. My father was a pastor. He started pastoring when I was 10 years old. And he started this thing at the end of our services where he would say, love everybody. And I believe that just kind of embedded that love inside of me for no matter who the individual is, no matter their walk of life or their culture, that you love everybody. And because God is love, that's what the church is called to. And I believe that unity in the church is love.
Jesus himself carries with him the character of unity, because he's drawing all people to himself, but not only that, he is part of a Trinity. So in Christ, part of that character of Christ is this sense of being in total agreement that God has with himself. And so it needs to be a chief characteristic amongst Christians.
I think that all of us can, if we're really honest, say, yeah, we're feeling the storm right now. We're looking out at, you know, what's happening in our world right now and the different things going on. And I think that we would all say, yeah, I'm feeling some fear and anxiety. Yeah. But what unifies us even bigger and even greater than that is Jesus and his perfect love. And just like the word says, that perfect love drives out all fear. That's what this is tonight. It's all of us coming together and putting our focus on him, not on the storm around us, but setting our eyes on him and worshiping him and loving him and allowing his love to come and drive out that fear. And that's where we find peace, and that's where we find our hope to stand on despite anything else going on.
A lot of life can be a battle between fear and faith, and I think what happens in worship, when we worship with our music, what we're doing is we're choosing to magnify the right stuff. So you can read news stories and hear reports, and some of it seems quite bleak. There's a lot of crazy stuff goes on in our world. I mean, you can look further afield than America, and every day there's something happening. You can look just within America, and there'll be a news story that's troubling, that's distressing in some form. You can look, don't have to look beyond your own life, do you? and your own circumstances, to be confronted with things that could make you anxious or fearful. And you see the psalmist, you know, in the Bible, the book of Psalms there, so often the psalmist is saying, oh, I'm not going to fear. You know, he's choosing to magnify faith over fear. He's choosing to focus on the right things. And that's what we do when we worship God in our music.
Yeah. I kind of shared my heart for the night, your response to me was one of the things that really blew the most wind in my sails in that night. And I don't even know if you remember what you said, but we were on the phone, and I was sharing this thing, and I was hoping you weren't going to go, yeah, I do a lot of those things, and I don't have time. But I remember you said, Chris, I'll usher, I'll open the doors, I'll do whatever you need to do, because I know that this is something that God wants. And you said this beautiful thing, and I'll let you expound on it, but I remember just looking at my phone going, this is why God led me to this guy. I said, it feels like the nation doesn't know which way to go. And I remember you said, well, I think it's because the church doesn't know which way to go. Mm-hmm. And the church keeps leading in politics and leading out with politics, and it's to lead with prayer. The church's place is to lead with prayer. And that, I was like, that's it. And I just so appreciate it. And each night, you kind of leading us in that way.
I'm so honored to be a part of this. And from the very first email and phone call that we had, I knew this is something that if you'd allow me to be a part of it, I'd be honored to be a part of it, because I just feel so good about it. It's just so right. Mm. You know, it's the kind of thing you think, now Jesus would do this if he were alive today. He'd say, let's all keep taking these concerns to God, to our Father, because only he can really bring about the healing that we want. And I do get concerned. It's a touchy topic, you know, how involved the church should be in politics. And
yeah,
of course we should all vote. And of course we should all have opinions. Yeah. and try to think it through. But I struggle. Sometimes I think that the church inadvertently teaches people to place their hopes in the government. And this government, I love our country. I'm extremely patriotic. But I'm realistic that nations come and nations go. And if the Lord tarries, this nation will go. And we will have served our purpose. Our job is to continue bringing the nation to Christ and asking him to do his work and to heal his people. We live in a country, live in a day that needs healing.
Yeah,
and this prayer, I mean, how can we come together as people if we're broken up inside, you know? And so if we can first allow God to heal us, then there's an opportunity for him to heal us as a people.
I wonder if you'd take a moment and let God love you. I mean, really love you. Deeper, more profoundly, more tenderly, more intimately. Let him love you. You're not an exception to his affection. He hasn't forgotten you. He's not abandoned you. He stands at the door and he knocks. Would you open the door? Would you let him come in? Would you let him love you? Let that love go deep. Let it soften the parts of your heart that are growing angry or hostile. There is fear in our world. It's a fragile, fragile time. But there is a King of Kings and there is a Lord of Lords. And there is a lover of souls. I'm sorry for every heartache that's come your way. I'm sorry for the person who said I do on your wedding day and said I don't every day after. I'm sorry that you were unfairly treated, inappropriately touched, blatantly disregarded. I'm sorry. Nobody gets through life unscathed. Everybody gets bruised. Everybody gets beaten. But listen, there is a love of the Almighty God. And this love will offset all the hurts, the hates, the heartaches that have come your way. I am sorry they have come, but there is a King who can take what was intended as evil and he can reroute it, he can reweave it, he can turn it into something good. But you got to let him love you. Oh Lord, 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 would you receive his love? Let's just receive it. Just receive it. Oh Holy Spirit, oh blessed Jesus, oh King, oh Shepherd of the flock, speak words, speak, speak, speak. Speak. Words of grace, words of grace. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Words of hope. For if anyone is in Christ, that person is a new creation. The old things have gone, the new things have come. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Words of guidance. You are our shepherd, the good shepherd. And you lead us, you guide us, you take us. Speak, speak. There's forgiveness coming to the darkest parts of hearts. Right now, forgiveness is coming. Right now. Physical healing. Emotional healing. We believe, Jesus, you can do more with one word than the best preachers can do with a billion words. Just one word, Lord. Just one word from you. Speak the word. For you are our Father. You're our Father. Isn't it great just to be in His presence? Just to be in His presence. Oh, dear children of God, sons and daughters of the King, just look at you. How special you are. You know, God wants you to call Him Father. When Jesus taught us to pray, He said, when you pray, just say, Our Father. It's His idea. It would have been right for you to Him to teach us to pray, our King in heaven, our Creator in heaven, our Maker in heaven. All of those would have been right. But of all the words that Jesus could have selected, He chose the word Father. In fact, over 200 times in the four Gospels, we find Jesus saying, Father. His first words, didn't you know I must be about my Father's business? His last words, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. He was always calling God Father. And even more, he was often calling God Abba, Father. You know, the word, it's a Hebrew term. It's a colloquial term. It's like daddy or pop or paw or papa or papai. Daddy, Abba. You want to touch God's heart? Call him Abba. Abba, Abba, oh dear Abba in heaven. Many years ago, my daughter and I were in Israel. We were in the city of Jerusalem, coming out of the old city, down a narrow trail through the Jaffa Gate, cobblestone streets, thick with people, many of whom were in a special celebration for the Hasidic Jewish community. And we were caught up in a river of humanity. And from the throng of the people, my daughter and I heard this voice, Abba, Abba. And we turned and looked, and there was a small girl, maybe 5 or 6 years of age. And somehow she'd gotten separated from her parents. And she was standing still like a statue. And all these people were pressing, and she was afraid, and she, Abba. And I stopped because I wanted to see what an Abba would do. Out of nowhere, there came this concerned father with his black hat and his long robe. Oh man, nothing was going to stop him. He could hear his child. Nothing was going to stop him. And he pressed through the crowd and he was searching and looking. And finally when he spotted her, he raced in her direction. And he lowered himself down and he looked at her eye to eye. And then he put his arms around her and he squeezed her to himself as if he could squeeze all the fear out of her. And then he pushed her back, and this time he had a little word with her. I couldn't understand the word, but I had a feeling what it was. Don't you wander off again. And then he pulled her close and she wrapped her arms around him and he lifted her up and she wrapped her legs around him. She wasn't about to let go this time. And they disappeared into the crowd and I had my picture. That's what an Abba does. Listen, you need an Abba Father. You think you need a new house. You think you need a new spouse. You think you need a new car. You think you need a new job. You think you need a new move. You think you need a new body. You think you need a new president. You think you need a new economy. Here's what you need. You need a God in heaven who says, call me your Abba, Abba, Abba. You call out to me and I'll listen. You call out to me and I'll come. You call out to me and I'll stop everything and I'll come and I'll put my arms around it and I'll just squeeze all the fear out of you. He will do that for you, oh dear child of the living God. I know what some of you are thinking. You're thinking, oh yeah, he'll do that for good people. He'll do that for people who haven't messed up their lives. He'll do that for people who haven't wasted half their years. He wouldn't do it for me, not me, measly, old, normal, ordinary, common, ho-hum me. He wouldn't do it for me. Really? Really? Because that's not what I read. I read that when you give your heart to Christ, he returns the favor and he places his heart within you. I read that when you give your life to Christ, he writes your name in a book that is called the Book of Life. I read that he has laid claim to you and he's not going to let go of you. I read that your Abba Father has blessed you with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, that you're a new creation and all things have passed away and behold, all things have become new. I read that you have obtained an inheritance, that you are heirs of God and you are joint heirs with Christ, that you are an ambassador of Christ. You're the fragrance of Christ. You're being transformed into the image of Christ. I read that you have been delivered from the power of darkness and conveyed into the kingdom of the Son. I read that no one will ever be able to snatch you out of the Father's hand. I don't think you're normal. I read that if you ask, you will receive. If you seek, you will find. If you knock, the door will be open for you. And whatever you ask in the name of your Father, that will be given to you. I even read this, that greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. Normal? I don't think so. You used to be normal. You used to be ho-hum. You used to be average. But then God got a hold of you and he placed himself within you. Now you are God's child. You're Christ's friend. You're a member of Christ's body. You're a saint. You're redeemed and forgiven of all your sins. You're complete in Christ, lacking in nothing. You're free from condemnation. You're God's co-worker. You're seated with Christ in the heavenly realm. You're God's workmanship. You're a citizen of heaven. You're adopted into God's family. Come on now. You're born of God, and the evil one cannot touch you. You've been bought with a price. You belong to God, and you cannot be separated from the love of God. I think your heavenly Father has a high affection for you. Amen. Amen. And this generation is in desperate need. In desperate need of a people who know who they are and to whom they belong and where they are headed. This is a generation of much know-how, not very much know-why. We're full of facts and information and technology, but we're clueless as to why we're on the face of the earth. But God is raising up a generation of people who will call Him Father, who will call Him Savior, who will trust Him and lean into Him and accept Him and live out their role as sons and daughters of the Most High God. You bear the name, a child of the living God. And when you speak, heaven listens. When you cry out, Abba, your heavenly Father finds you. He dispatches angels to guard you. When you walk up and down the hallway of your house, calling for the presence of the Holy Spirit comes. When you walk through your neighborhood, asking for the Lord to bless the neighborhood with peace and redemption, that's exactly what comes. It is time for us as God's church, God's bride, God's children, to exercise the clout of God's name. As we call out and we ask for help, Lord, would you come? Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And He will hear that prayer, not because we're worthy, but because He's our Father. And you know what? He's a good, good.
Perfect in all of
so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are
your glory, God, is what I
I love that, you know, all of us, and I'm reminded every time we sing, every time, you know, we come together to church, that we are all on, we all start in the same place. We all start in a place of brokenness, a place of, you know, our flesh, our sinful nature, our sinful selves. All humanity is on kind of equal ground there. And no matter where you come from, no matter what you're born into, no matter what background you come from, no matter what color your skin, we're all kind of born in the same place. And the gospel, the good news is that Jesus came to free us of that. And when he said, I come to give you life and life to the fullest, he was saying, I've come to break all those chains, to break those things. That's what the cross has done. It breaks those chains that hold us down, that holds us on this earth and to set us free. And man, that's what we proclaimed even tonight. That's what we proclaim is the freedom of God.
And I think, you know, that kind of a freedom, it's a greater freedom than any freedom a country will ever give you.
Absolutely.
And that's the freedom that compels you to want to work for all kinds of freedom in the world. But you never lose sight of that. You never lose sight that the freedom that you're ultimately really talking about is the freedom that comes from knowing you're loved by God. Mm-hmm. And it motivates you to work to create a place of opportunity or a place where that freedom is, you know, made evident in its laws and in the way that people relate to one another.
Yeah.
And, you know, when I think about proclaiming prayers and living out a life that proclaims that freedom, I want it to be a freedom that is primarily freedom for and not just freedom from, mm-hmm. in the sense that, like, I never lose sight of the fact that Jesus freed me from my sin, but I also know that Jesus set me free so that I could have life to the fullest. Mm-hmm. And I think that translates into the way in which we share the gospel with people. I think a lot of people feel like sharing the gospel these days is, well, I got to defend it. And I'm like, man, that's a small gospel, first of all, if it depends on you to defend it. Like, God amazing. Of the universe.
Yes, he needs you.
That's it. You're on the front line of defense.
No one's figured it out up till this moment. It's on you. It's all on you.
And I think that's too much pressure for any man to take on himself. I think I want a faith not that's defendable. I want a faith that's undeniable.
If you know there's power in the name of Jesus, somebody shout that name, Jesus. Shout the name, Jesus. Shout the name, Jesus. Come on, scream his name until the nation responds. Somebody shout the name, Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain. Let's say it together. There is power.
There is power.
Come on. We know what the power is. Shout, there is power.
There is power.
Break every chain. I feel the power in the room. Say,
to break every chain, break every chain, break every.
Somebody put your hands in the air right here. Let's do it together.
There's an army rising up.
Come on, kingdom of God, shout. There's an army.
There's an army.
Now shout it out, say to break every chain, to break every chain,
You know, we sang and we heard earlier that God's a good, good Father. And that's so powerful for every one of us to know that we have a relationship with God where we can call the Almighty our Father. But I want you to know tonight, He's not only a good, good Father, God is also a good, good fighter. Your Father in heaven is a good fighter. I don't mean fighting against people. I mean fighting against all the powers of the darkness that come against your life. And He is standing in this night, ready to fight on behalf of every one of us who puts our trust in Him. I love that story in the Old Testament, King Jehoshaphat. They came to him and they said, there's an army coming against us. In fact, it wasn't an army, it was three armies coming against the people of God. Have you ever been at that place in life where it wasn't one thing, it was one thing, and all of a sudden it was another thing, and you thought, how can it be two things? And all of a sudden it was three things. And you thought, I'm not really prepared to face one of these giant circumstances. But while we were dealing with the cancer, we got a phone call that somebody's relationship fell apart. And while we were dealing with that situation, we got a phone call and something else came crashing in. And that was where Jehoshaphat found himself. Three armies coming against the people of God. But he was a wise leader, and we need wise leaders in our nation and in our world right now. Jehoshaphat was a wise leader, and he did what wise leaders did. He called all the people together and said, we are going to seek God together, and we are going to pray, because that's what you do when three calamities are crashing in at one time. And so they called the people together, and Jehoshaphat said something extraordinary. He said, God, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. What a powerful thing just to admit the facts and to say, you know, we don't have all the answers. And right now, we're living in such uncertain times in our nation right now. But we must remember that in uncertain times, we're standing on a sure foundation. We are standing, even in this night, on the rock of ages. And you know that not when your gaze is locked on the circumstances around you, but when you lift, when we lift our eyes up to heaven and we remember who it is that created this world and created every single one of us, and we remember that our Father is in charge of the world. They don't call it history for nothing. It really is His story. He's the one who started it. He's the one who sustains it. He's the one that's going to finish it. It's going to happen exactly the way that God wants it to happen. The fate of our nation is not in the hands of a president. The fate of the world is not in the hands of a parliament or a prime minister or a cabinet or a premier or an Ayatollah. No, the one who knows the beginning from the end, the first from the last, who sees it all right now. He is sovereign. He is sovereign over all the affairs of the world, and He is sovereign over us in this moment. And when we lift our eyes up to Him and admit to Him, we don't have all the answers. We don't have solutions. We don't know what to do, but our eyes are on You. And God loves that posture. He responded to Jehoshaphat. I want you to hear what He said to him. This is in 2 Chronicles 20. He said, "You will not have to fight this battle." Now, don't you want to hear God speak that over your life tonight? And don't we need to hear God speak that over our nation and our world tonight? You will not have to fight this battle. Take up your positions. So you are going to have to go. You're going to have to be involved. You're going to have to stand your ground. You're going to have to take your place. But standing your ground and taking your place is different than carrying the weight of fighting the war. He said, you're going to take up your position. But here's what I want you to do. Stand firm and see the deliverance the Lord will give you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Go out and face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you. And when Jehoshaphat heard that, he believed it. When he heard that, he believed, wow, God has spoken. God is involved. God is on the scene. God is on our side. God is going to fight for us. And so they did exactly that. They went out the next day to face three armies, but when they did, Jehoshaphat was so convinced of the promise of God that he put the choir in front of the army. He said, "Today, the singers are going to lead us out in battle." Now, if you were in the army, you were pretty excited because you'd already heard that there were three armies waiting for you. And the fact that Jehoshaphat wanted to put the choir in front was a good idea. Now, if you were in the choir, this came as a bit of a shock and a surprise to you, because when you signed up for the choir, you weren't expecting to be able to take up the lead position into the battle. But Jehoshaphat was so convinced that God's promise was going to come true that he put a choir in the front. And you know what they sang while they went out into the battle? They didn't sing some, you know, complicated, you know, multiverse hymn even. They just sang this simple refrain: "Give thanks to the Lord, His love endures forever." They were so sure of their God that they sang a hymn, a song of praise to the God whose love was going to win the day. Now, if you were one of those three armies, you hear a choir coming, you know, there was probably a scout on the front, and he sees the choir coming, and he reports back, you know, to the armies, "Well, what's happening?" "Well, I don't know. There's a choir coming at us." "Well, what are they singing?" "Something like, 'We're going to kill you and destroy you and tear you apart.'" No. They're singing, "Give thanks to the Lord. His love endures forever." And I'm sure the other army generals were not too intimidated by that, but they were going to find out in a hurry that when God is fighting for you, something supernatural and spectacular is about to happen. And that's what happened in that day. Those armies turned on each other and then turned on themselves. And when the people of God crested over the hill, they saw the result of what God had done. And if there was ever a moment in the history of this nation when we need to take that exact same posture and that exact same approach, it is this day. And if there was an ever a moment that we need leaders and we need people to rise up and say, you know, God, we don't know what to do. So what we are going to do, God, is set our gaze on you. We're going to do what the psalmist said. When the psalmist said, I lift my eyes to the hills, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And this is where our help comes from in this day. Our help is not coming from people. God will appoint people to lead our nation, and we will honor them, and we will pray for them. But our help will not come from people. Our help comes from the Lord. And that's why we, as the people of God, have an opportunity tonight to change the direction of our future. It may be tonight that the hope of the world is a 20-inch journey to mercy. Do you know it's only 20 inches to mercy? That's true for us as a nation tonight. It's true for you as a family tonight. Maybe you need some massive breakthrough of God in your marriage. Maybe your children are who knows where tonight, and you're so concerned for their well-being. Maybe there's sickness or cancer or some prognosis that's crashed into your world. Maybe it's something internal, some pressure, some depression, some oppression. Anxiety, darkness has just pressed into your world, and the offer is the same. It's 20 inches to mercy for all of us tonight. And the 20 inches to mercy simply represents the distance from where our knees are to where the ground is. It's that 20-inch journey from here to here that might break open the door of God's mercy in our lives. God said, first, we've got to humble ourselves and pray. And we've told each other what our opinions are, but have we cried out to God for what only He can do? And this proposition is powerful because it rests with the people of God. He didn't say, if those people will do something, I'll heal the land. He didn't say, if somebody will do something, I'll heal the land. He said, no, if my people will humble themselves and pray, that's going to trigger the avalanche of forgiveness and healing for the nation. And so it may just be tonight that the healing of our nation rests on the prayers of God's people. I don't know when the last time was that you were on your knees before Almighty God, but I know it's the last time you felt really peaceful about your future and really confident that the God who is your Father is fighting your battles for you. And yes, you'll have to show up, but you won't have to fight. God is fighting for you, so you can step into the moment with worship in your mouth. Because worship, come on, it's not ancillary to the church. It's not a footnote in the church. No, that choir led them out with confidence because worship, it's so appropriate in the noonday sun. It's so appropriate when life is going great. Worship is the right response when everything's happening the way we had hoped. But I'm telling you, when it is the darkest night, worship of the living God is a wrecking ball to the kingdom of darkness. It pierces through the darkness and it ushers in the light of God's glory. And so for us tonight to bow and to pray and then to stand and to worship is to do the exact right thing in this moment in time. And so I want you to think with me right now about what it would look like if we could find our ways our way to our knees. Just think of it this way. Imagine if I told you there was $1,000 under every seat. And so if you're in a theater, I invite you. If you're in a church, I invite you. And anywhere in Madison Square Garden, from the top to the bottom, if it's at all physically possible, could we take that journey tonight? And could we humble ourselves together? If you can only get one knee on the ground, I encourage you to do that. If it's just scooting to the edge of your chair, then I encourage you to do that. But could we find a way, all of us, into this place of humility? And as we bow down, could we just claim this moment as a holy moment? And so I want to encourage you. We've had a great opportunity to lift our voices tonight, but could we just let this be a holy moment? And I want to give you and each one of us personally just a moment to say to God, I don't know how long it's been since you've been on your knees. I want to give you a moment just to say to him, God, here I am. I really don't know what to do for our nation, but I don't know what to do for my business right now. I don't know what to do for my wife, my kids right now. I don't know what to do about my sanity right now. I don't know what to do facing up against this addiction right now. I don't know what to do facing up against this darkness, this pressure, this prognosis. And so I'm just humbled before you, God, as your son, as your daughter, asking you to have mercy on me. And just thank him. Tell him you do believe he's a good father. He's not the reflection of your earthly dad, just a bigger version of what you had. He's the perfection of your earthly dad. He's everything you've ever wanted. And just thank him tonight. Tell him, I believe, God, that you're a good father and that your plans for me are good. And I believe that you're fighting my battles for me. So I let go and I trust and believe you are doing what I cannot do, accomplishing what I can't accomplish, winning what I can't win. Father, see your people, your sons and daughters, north, south, east, and west, all here bowed down before you, lifting our eyes up to your great and glorious throne, to that place where you are seated on high tonight, that unassailable throne of thrones, where you hold the name that is above every name, the title that is above every title, the authority that is above every authority. So we don't idly spend these moments. No, we reach out to you, the one who holds history in your hands. And we take you at your word tonight. We take you at your word, God. And so there is no if in the equation tonight. We are your people called by your name, and we are humbling ourselves, and we are praying, and we are seeking your face tonight, and we are turning from our wicked ways. God, we are sorry for the foolish choices we've made. Every one of us has been prideful. Every one of us has been arrogant. Every one of us has taken the wheel. Every one of us has tried to do it in our own strength and our own ability. We've walked away from your truth. We have dug holes that hold no water. We have lifted up little tiny idols that can't do a thing or hear anything or say anything, but yet we've been so enamored by them and by this world. We've looked less distinct and more like the world. We've loved the darkness at times more than the light. We've been distracted and infatuated by the here and now, and we've lost sight of our great future with you. So we just say, as a people and as a nation tonight, we're sorry, and we ask you, God, to help us to stand, to rise in this moment into your mercy, your grace, and your truth over our lives. Lord, we thank you that we are kneeling at the foot of a cross where the greatest of love was displayed for all of us. We thank you that there is forgiveness even now. There is cleansing even now for every single one of us, no one too far, for the power and the grace that have been displayed in Jesus. And God, we pray for our nation. We pray for our president tonight. We lift President Obama up to you in Jesus' name. We pray even in these final months, you would assist him, you would help him, God, that you would give him extraordinary, supernatural understanding, insight, and wisdom to lead our nation. Strengthen and support him in every way in his family. God, we pray tonight for Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, one of whom in just a few days will be elected the president of this nation. We lift them up to you from our knees in the name of Jesus, God. You created them. They are yours. We ask you in Jesus' name, help them, God. Support them, God. Bring people around them, voices around them, encouragement around them, truth around them, God, that would allow them to tap into your supernatural understanding, to your unshakable wisdom, to your heart of justice and truth for all people. God, will you give them the ability they could never imagine in their own strength to rise up as your man, your woman in this hour for this nation and this world. Fill them with humility, God, and courage to know that God Almighty is available. God Almighty is available. So lift us up, God, full of worship, full of confidence, full of praise in the name of Jesus, God. And in that name we pray that you would save this nation, save our people, and save us, God, so that you would receive glory now and forevermore. That's our prayer. That's our hope. In Jesus' name.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Is more where grace is found is where you are, and where you are, Lord. defense, my righteousness. Oh God, my name. There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation, Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us. Jesus, Jesus. Who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me.
Sing it together.
Celebrate a little bit in this house. Come on.
The tide is rising, rising. We got any crazy folks out there? Any dancers out there? Come on! All together!
I'm coming back to the start, where you found me. I'm coming back to your heart. Now I surrender. Take me. This is all I can bring.
All the dancers, you ready?
Yeah.
You guys lead this tonight.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Oh my soul. Worship His holy name.
And sing like this. Back to one name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be saved when the evening comes.
We say,
bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy.
Yeah. So sing like never before. Oh.
We love you so much.